Thank you very much, sir. And it's a pleasure and delight and honor to be invited to give this lecture. It's not often that one gets an opportunity, here I have the same warning that he has, to both visit a place and see so many old friends, and I really appreciate that opportunity. Let's see, I guess this doesn't automatically change, but let me start by saying, suppose I tell you that there's a device that can store 3 billion bits of information and process that information using thousands of different programs, that device can detect and analyze environmental signals. It can manufacture and install the sensors it needs to do this. Suppose I also said that device can produce hundreds of different chemical substances, make copies of itself, and modify these for specialized tasks. But that's not all. That device can create networks to communicate with similar devices, and it can do all this in a space smaller than the point of a pin, 1/10 millionth of a meter. Now you might say, who invented that device? IBM, Mitsubishi, perhaps Siemens? I'm going to go out and invest in that company. But you'd be out of luck because that device is a living cell, as I think everyone probably would have guessed. And the thing that makes that device capable of doing all of these varied things is a wonderful chemical molecule called DNA. And the ability to manipulate what cells do involves manipulating its DNA. And two important goals of biological research are to understand how cells function in health and disease, and to manipulate the functions of cells to treat disease. And I'm going to be talking about these various things. The kind of cell that is the start of this story is a microbial cell. This is Department of Microbiology, I guess, is part of the origin of the invitation. And the a single-celled microbe, seen only with a microscope, called E. coli, and a DNA circle called a plasmid. Now, plasmids are circular molecules of DNA. Here you can see in one of our early isolations, open circle. They're actually isolated from cells as these tightly coiled, supercoiled DNA molecules. And if you nick them, they open up in our circles. And the other component of the origin of this story is the sobering statement, which is perhaps best summarized by this statement in 1993 by Joshua Lederberg, that barring genosuicide, the human dominion is challenged only by pathogenic microbes, for whom we remain the prey and they the predator. Now, that's a somber kind of statement. And here I've been saying that microbes are the origin of all these good things that I'm going to tell you about. But the nature of the questions that started the research that will be the subject of this particular talk is to deal with the question, as has already been mentioned, of antibiotic resistance. So let me take you back many years to before, looking around the audience before most of you were born, to 1968. So 1968 was almost 150 years after Ørsted's famous experiment, the discovery of electromagnetism, shown here, and really some years after his death. 1968, let me see if I can get some more of, okay. 1968 was 102 years after the publication by Gregor Mendel of his analysis of pea shoots and genetic inheritance, the founder of modern genetics. In the US, 1968 was a rather tumultuous year. It was a year that Martin Luther King, the great civil rights leader, was assassinated. Robert Kennedy, the brother of the assassinated president, was also assassinated. Nixon won by a thin margin. But it was also the year that the Beatles were popular in the US and Star Trek was watched on TV. And it was also the year that a four-year Porsche was introduced. But in Denmark, I guess, things were a little more less tumultuous. It was the year that Princess Benedict was married. It was a time that there was the Space Odyssey was a popular movie, and the Hep Stars were an album, and Fleetwood Mac was here in Copenhagen. It's a time when people largely drove Saabs and Volvos instead of Mazdas and Toyotas and whatever. And it was different in a lot of other ways. Let's see. Okay, I'm ahead of myself. It was a year that copiers began to be used. The first Xerox was actually sold. Before that, we used to write grants with carbon paper and many copies and make corrections. The fax machine had been invented previously, but there were no faxes as we know them today. There certainly were no cell phones, not even the old luggage type, let alone the pocket type that we have today. There were certainly no word processors. Computing, personal computing was done. This was the version of a personal computer, a PDP-11 with which we communicated by a teletype machine. The journals that we read in my particular field were the PNAS, which was the leading journal, the JBC, the Journal of Molecular Biology, the Journal of Bacteriology, and Nature. At that time, cell and molecular microbiology, major journals today, didn't exist. Science was a second-rate journal, and it remained that for many years after 1968 until Dan Koshlin became editor and revolutionized the journal. Actually, people went to rooms called libraries. And they actually would rummage around on the shelves and look at the journals. They would read current contents to get the prediction of what kinds of, let's see, maybe I can do this in a better way so I can have the full screen. Let's see if we can change that. I don't see the kind of indicator I usually have on my computer. Okay, thank you. When we gave lectures, we didn't use PowerPoint with all of these obvious things to deal with. We used lantern projectors and large slides like this that often became cracked. There was the beginning of slide cassettes, just beginning at that time. Let's see, whoops. There were no genomics, no transcriptomics, no proteomics, no metabolomics, only, as Sidney Brenner likes to say, economics. This is the only omics that existed. There were no gels for DNA and protein analysis, or for no northern, western, or southern blotting. There was no chemical synthesis of oligonucleotides. There was limited ability to label nucleotides. Restriction enzymes were phenotype-based phenomena, not laboratory tools. There's no plasmid DNA transformation, only barely plasmid DNA isolation. There was obviously no DNA cloning, since that's what I'm going to tell you about. There was no DNA sequencing. There are no reporter genes, epitope tag proteins, confocal microscopy, transgenic animals. None of the tools, or not hardly any of the tools that we use in our laboratories today in commonplace. So one can say, well, how did anyone do any kinds of experiments? Well, the tools that we had at the time were, of course, the microscope, which had been invented a couple of centuries previously. There was something old as a Bunsen burner, and there were these loops that one used to spread bacteria on petri dishes and watch them grow. To understand relationships between macromolecules, between DNA and other molecules of DNA, and DNA and RNA, there were hybridization boxes where one would put things on a filter and see what else stuck to it on the filter because of complementarity of sequence between the two DNA species or between the DNA and RNA. There were these instruments, which there may still be around. There was a Model E analytical ultracentrifuge and a preparative ultracentrifuge, both of which were invented by Arnold Beckman. And theirs was the old Beckman DU spectrophotometer that we used for determining optical density of substances. And there was an electron microscope. And with these tools, we began to study antibiotic resistance. Now, I should say that infectious diseases was an old and long-standing problem. In fact, plagues of biblical proportions went back to the plague of the Philistines in the 11th century, and there were other plagues that happened, the first documented pandemic, Justinian's plague, and there was the advent of the bubonic plague brought to Europe by the invading a Golden Horde. And in Kaffa, a port on the, where are we, in the Black Sea, there was the first instance of, whoops, it's not showing up, interestingly, of biological warfare in the 14th century. And I should say there was the Siege of Kaffa, in which the invaders took catapults with the decaying bodies and catapulted them over the walls of the defending city in order to infect the defenders. But mankind began to fight back, and some of the first fighting back came from the invention of or discovery of antibiotics, almost 40 years or 40 years prior to 1968 was the discovery of penicillin, or at least the mold from which it came, by Alexander Fleming. And in 1944, the discovery by Albert Schatz and Selman Weizmann of streptomycin. And close to the end of World War II, penicillin was used to save troops in the field. And the notion was, thanks to penicillin, lives would be saved. And other antibiotics began to appear on the scene. And there was the prediction that the worldwide eradication of bacterial infections would occur using drugs that attack microbes. But that notion dissolved. And the reason for that was the advent of antibiotic resistance, which first appeared in Japan in the late 1950s. And by the late 1960s, you can see that a large percentage of, in this instance, this was Shigella, or resistant to antibiotics, and the black part of the bar refers to the multiply resistant strains. So not only were they resistant, but they were multiply resistant. And it was discovered by genetic experiments that this resistance was largely due to little DNA circles called plasmids, which exist in the cells of bacteria in addition to the chromosome. And plasmids can be seen, or could be seen even then, in this photomicrograph taken by Jack Griffith, where E. coli was disrupted and its DNA spread out on an electron microscope grid. And here off in the on the side is a little separate piece of DNA, separate from the chromosome, the plasmid. And in our earlier work, we were able to isolate plasmids and began to study what they looked like and what their properties were. I should say, I think many of you know, certainly the biologists, that bacteria have sex. And microbial sex is the way in which plasmids were transferred. And you can see in these conjugating bacteria where an organelle called a pilus is outlined by a bacteriophage that adheres to it, bacteria are mating. Because of the ability of bacteria to mate, plasmids could be transferred among bacterial species. So a cell that originally had a plasmid not only could transmit that to its progeny when it divided, but also transmit it laterally to other bacteria, some of which were more pathogenic than the original host of the plasmid. And then when the recipient divided, it would transmit its plasmid to the progeny and so on. And this way, resistance spread through the population. And genetic studies had shown that these plasmids consisted of a replication region, which somehow could pick up or would attach to ancillary genes. And the ancillary genes were rather interesting. Antibiotic resistance was one type of gene. Some genes that plasmids carried had encoded antibiotic production, heavy metal resistance, virulence. There was a tumorigenic plasmid in plants. There was the ability to transfer themselves, genes that did that, toxin production, the restriction modification enzymes that I've already mentioned and I'll say more about, and various kinds of metabolic genes. There were a group of plasmid biologists, and these were the people at the time, a number of them from Japan, some in Europe. Kurt Nordstrom was among the early plasmid biologists, Royston Clowes from UK, and some in the US whose names you're familiar with. And in 1968, this was the year that I began my laboratory at Stanford. And I went to visit a colleague who was a senior colleague in the Department of Biochemistry, whose name I won't mention, except he's known for his work with DNA. And when I had known this person previously, and I told him that I was going to work on plasmids. He said, plasmids? He said, everything that it's important to know about plasmids must already be known. Why don't you work on something important? And by something important, what he really meant was bacteriophage. Molecular biology had arisen largely through studies of bacteriophage, and I'll tell you why that happened in just a moment. But I decided stubbornly, those of you who know me know that I've always been a little bit stubborn, to work on plasmids. And some of the questions that I was interested in asking and answering are shown here. Where did plasmid genes originate? How did plasmids evolve? How do they replicate? What controls their copy number? What mechanisms mediate their transfer among bacterial populations? How is plasmid gene replication controlled? And is there communication between plasmids and host bacteria? And the tools I've already mentioned, we use the centrifuges that I've told you about, and using that, it was possible for us to separate different species of plasmid DNA by the preparative ultracentrifuge and to study them using analytical ultracentrifuge, and then use the electron microscope to study relationships among plasmids. And we did that using an archaic method called heteroduplex analysis, a technique that was invented by both Václav Jabalsky and Ron Davis at Wisconsin, and Ron Davis and Norman Davidson at Caltech. And if one takes two plasmid DNA strands and anneals them together, one can see the thick area is the area where they're homologous, and one could see these loops where the two DNAs were different. And using this, we were studying plasmid relationships and beginning to look at how plasmids were evolved. And in the course of these experiments, we noticed something rather interesting, and that was that when you looked at some plasmids, one could see hairpin loops, these thick area stems with a loop at the end. And I'm not going to go into that, but you can see here's a very good example of one. It looks almost like a tennis racket sitting on a piece of circular DNA. And these, of course, are transposable genetic elements. Transposable genetic elements weren't discovered on plasmids. They were discovered by Barbara McClintock in maize, perhaps two decades earlier than that. But it was possible, using the methods I've mentioned, to learn that plasmids and resistance genes on plasmids really often resulted from the accumulation of different genes by transposable elements accumulating on plasmids. The genes could jump from plasmid to plasmid. But there were some limitations to what we can do with the methods that I've already described. And those limitations, it was apparent to me, were because plasmids, unfortunately, were not viruses, that the person who advised me, in one sense, was right. There are things that you could do with bacteriophage that you couldn't do with plasmids. And what was that? Well, the important thing is you could clone phage. And that happened in the natural process of a phage life cycle. A single solitary phage molecule would infect a bacterial cell and produce hundreds or thousands of copies of itself. So you could start out and see the progeny of a single DNA molecule. And I realized, because I had studied phage as a postdoc, that in order to really understand plasmid biology, it would be necessary to clone individual plasmid DNA molecules. And we set up to do that using a procedure that was a modification of something that had been used to introduce phage DNA into bacteria. And that's if you treat E. coli with calcium chloride, you can make a permeable competent cell. And here you have a plasmid DNA that we isolated as a circle. And we could get it to take up, we could get the cell to take up the plasmid DNA. And using the antibiotic resistance genes carried by the plasmid, we could isolate colonies that express the resistance of the plasmid. And each of these colonies had cells that all were identical, carrying the plasmid DNA that was identical to the original molecule that was taken up by a cell. And the ability to clone plasmid DNA, this has nothing to do with genetic engineering at this point, was for me a very important step in allowing the subsequent steps to occur. And the reason for that is because of the nature of DNA and DNA replication itself. As you all know, when DNA replicates, each strand makes a copy of itself, so that if another piece of DNA is spliced into the parental molecule, the DNA that it makes also contains a copy of the segment that would have been inserted. And so I realized that if it were possible to take plasmids out of cells and put them back into cells, perhaps it would be possible to splice some DNA segment into the plasmid DNA and have the plasmid replication machinery reproduce the foreign DNA in much the same way that transposons and antibiotic resistance genes and other genes could be carried by plasmids using natural mechanisms. Now, there were, by this time it was the early 1970s, and there were ways of splicing DNA together. The original experiment showing that was shown by Vittorio Scaramella, who was a postdoc in Gobind Khurana's lab, and they published this in the PNAS in 1970. By using the enzyme from bacteriophage T7, a ligase, it was possible to splice together blunt-ended DNA. And Khurana and his collaborators used also other ways of joining genes together. Using complementarity, they synthesized little segments of DNA and really using overlapping complementarity could build up genes. And using that, Khurana synthesized the tRNA gene for which he received the Nobel Prize. And there were still other methods of joining together pieces of DNA. One could take one piece of DNA and another piece of DNA and add a series of T's onto one piece of DNA and a series of A's onto the other, and then join them together and get a closed circular DNA. And this was shown, originally it was reported by an industrial lab, which no one has ever heard of, Jensen et al. In 1971. They published it in an obscure journal, but they were really the first to join DNA by complementarity. Peter Loban and Dale Kaiser really developed a method for doing this and getting ligation. And Jackson, Simons, and Berg used that method, as they cite in their paper, to join together DNA from two separate sources, SV40 and Lambda. Well, around this time, there was a meeting, a plasmid DNA meeting, which was held in Hawaii. Now, I don't know whether any of you have been to Hawaii, but it's a very beautiful place with beautiful beaches and lots of sun and palms waving in the breeze. But this meeting was held in a windowless room, as you see. That was not to distract us. And here are some of the people of the early days of plasmid biology. Some of you may recognize. This is the late Bob Round, who was a leader in studying plasmids in the early years. He died of pancreatic carcinoma about 15 years ago. This is Don Kluhl. This is Richard Novick, who some of you know. And this is a guy whose beard was still black, even though his head was balding at this particular session. And at that meeting, I heard Herbert Boyer, who wasn't really working on plasmids, but Don Helinski and I, who co-chaired the meeting, invited him because he was working with a restriction enzyme that was encoded by a plasmid, ECOR1. And we knew about this, and this enzyme had really remarkable properties, and it recognized DNA sequences called palindromes. And that, and palindromes, as some of you know, are sequences that these are word palindromes that read the same in both directions. Abel was I, air I, so Alba, a man, a plan, a canal, Panama, madam, I'm Adam, and you can do these word games. And at one point, a few years ago, I gave a talk and I saw a student in the second row scribbling really energetically, and I thought he was taking notes on what I was saying. But it turned out after the talk, he rushed up to me, he said, I have another palindrome I came up with that you should put on your slide. I said, well, what is it? He said, sex at noon taxes. it's a palindrome. Anyway, ECOR1 recognizes a particular sequence, and because DNA, of course, has polarity, it has a 5' end and a 3' end, the sequences, the GAATTC, are in the 5' to 3' direction on both strands. And this enzyme had an interesting property. Instead of cleaving the sequence it recognized down at the axis of symmetry, it cleaved asymmetrically between the G and the A and this strand, and between the G and the A on this strand. This is a little off register. And that was shown by three laboratories who published in 1972 in the same issue of the PNAS. And I realized that, that it might be possible to use this overlapping complementarity to join together pieces of other types of DNA into plasmids. And one of the nights, getting out of that windowless room, a number of us went for a walk along Waikiki Beach and ended up in a delicatessen. And this is a cartoon that was drawn some years later by a cartoonist of a Hawaii paper, sort of commemorating the event, which was the destruction of the deli for building a high-rise building or something. But the people that were there, this is Herb, either saying that DNA has two strands or probably more likely ordering a couple more beers. There was Stanley Falco and Charles Brinton, and Charles Brinton's wife, Ginger. And at that, I proposed the collaboration that really led to the ability to study individual genetic segments of plasmids. And the strategy was to take the large antibiotic resistance plasmid, R65, which carried a number of different kinds of resistances, and to cut it with ECOR1 into its multiple fragments, and to allow these fragments to associate randomly in a test tube, and then to add DNA ligase, an enzyme that allowed these ends to be joined together, and then to use the transformation procedure to introduce the collection of ligated fragments into bacterial cells, and to select for individual resistances carried by the parental plasmid with a hope that perhaps in this random collection there would be an association of individual resistance genes with a replication region, and that we might use this to clone the fragments that carry the individual resistance genes and therefore be able to map them and study them. And in fact, that was possible. The plasmid that we isolated was PSC102, and here are some of the fragments of the parental plasmid, and you see this new plasmid carried three fragments. One of them is the replication region of the fragment, the other carried a kanamycin gene, and another one came along for the ride. But in order to really do DNA cloning in a practical way, we realized that we needed a vector. And we looked around, a vector molecule would be one that would be cut only once. It would have a single ECOR1 site, which was the only restriction enzyme that was available for these types of experiments in those days. And it would make the sticky ends. And that cleavage site would not, if in an ideal world, cut the replication machinery or the resistance gene that the plasmid had that we would use to select for it. And in my a collection of plasmids at Stanford. After a lot of screening, we found such a molecule, which was PSC101, which was the first DNA cloning vector, as Søren has mentioned. And the procedure, which is the we wrote as the DNA cloning procedure, there was the replication machinery, the EcoR1 cleavage site, the resistance gene. We were able to open the plasmid, take fragments from another plasmid carrying different resistances, add them to the PSC101, and use the ligase and transformation and clone the fragments of foreign DNA using this vector. So that was possible, and I was very excited about that, obviously. The next question was, could these procedures be used to clone foreign DNA? So far, we're talking about just E. coli. And I thought it might be possible to clone plasmid fragments from another species, Staphylococcus aureus, which is very different from E. coli, as I think most of you know. In addition to the morphological differences, there are a lot of genetic differences. And this carried a penicillin resistance gene, a particular plasmid called PI258 that we had gotten from Richard Novick. And could we join this to PSC101 and get that to be replicated in a foreign host? And I discussed this with my colleagues at Stanford. And again, while Stan, there's no way for this to work, species barriers prevent even phage from growing on unrelated bacteria. There are natural boundaries, and I don't know if this is going to work. But in fact, we were able to take the staphylococcal plasmid, extract the DNA, cleave it into fragments, select for penicillin resistance gene carried by this plasmid, and add it to the tetracycline resistance PSC101 replicon, and create a plasmid to contain two fragments of totally unrelated DNA. And this is a quote that you've already seen from Søren's introduction. Thank you. I won't have to go into that again. But we realized that it might be possible to do some very interesting things with these methods. And we're very eager to try to see if we could clone fragments of eukaryotic DNA, making it possible to take apart the chromosomes of complicated cells and to clone them in the same way that I've described, by adding them to plasmids, getting a collection, and getting individual bacteria, each of which carried a different fragment of the eukaryotic chromosome. And of course, that was possible, as you all now know. But there was another side to this, and that's that while those of us doing these experiments were very happy with what you could do with plasmids, there were some people that weren't so happy. And the notion was this was playing God with DNA, the idea that you could make new genetic combinations that didn't exist previously worried people in terms of the biohazards. And I, frankly, was one of the people that had those some of those concerns. We really were very careful not to introduce any antibiotic resistance gene combinations that didn't exist in nature. But the press picked up some of these concerns, and there was a lot written at the time. And this is a cover for some popular journal at the time, which I think depicts the feeling. Here are a group of scientists building a DNA molecule that's a serpent that obviously is going to come down and attack them. And you'll notice that there's a guy here with a beard and glasses and bald head who's putting a blue gene into a red helix. And I don't want to sound paranoid about this, but this was what was depicted in the literature at the time. And in fact, it was viewed as a ban on genetic engineering. And in fact, plasmids had such a bad name at the time that some people said, yeah, well, we shouldn't use plasmids for genetic engineering. We should do this with viruses, because plasmids were these evil antibiotic resistance molecules. But the ultimate concern, this wasn't from a journal at the time, but as you see, the child is a clone of the mother, and the cover, like mother, like daughter. And here's the test tube. And that was ultimately the concern, that the ability to clone genes of bacterial DNA and plasmids, or even eukaryotic genes, would ultimately lead to human DNA cloning. So there or some issues there, but the issues, the concerns gradually subsided, and the methods were used to study the genetic composition of plasmids, to clone the replication regions of plasmids and study their replication, to answer a lot of the questions that I wanted to ask when I started my laboratory, to make reporter genes, to find genes that could be used to identify genetic control signals, et cetera. Reporter genes, by the way, were invented by a guy who unfortunately died a few years ago of Yersinia pestis infection, Malcolm Cassidaban, who was a postdoc in my lab and who had the concept of reporter genes when he was a graduate student in John Beckwith's lab at Harvard, and who came to my lab as a postdoc, and we worked out a scheme for using reporter genes to clone genetic control signals. Well, now, as you know, the methods I've talked about are used in fermentation to make all kinds of things in that are useful. Medically important proteins, novel diagnostics, even some aspects of gene therapy, to use microbial production of chemicals and various other things. But importantly, the elucidation of fundamental biological processes that affect the workings of genes in health and disease, I think, is the most important use of this methodology. So, okay, fast forward for the rest of my talk. So this is history. Have we solved the problem of antibiotic resistance, which is what this was all about to begin with? I mean, I didn't set out to invent genetic engineering. I set out to understand antibiotic resistant plasmids, and unfortunately, the answer, as we all know, is no, that antibiotic resistance continues to be with us, and infectious disease continues to be a worldwide problem. And the reason for this is largely because of the conventional approach to antimicrobial therapy, and that is to attack the pathogen. And in every other area of medicine, when pharmaceuticals are developed, they attack genes or gene products that the patient has, whether they're treating hypertension or psychiatric disease or whatever. But in infectious disease, for historical reasons, the notion was to attack the pathogen and leave the host untouched. And that has allowed pathogens to develop resistance to antimicrobials. And the reason is pretty clear, because there are billions of pathogens around. And if you have a drug, there's in that population of pathogens, there are a few that are mutated, and they're selected by the use of the drug. And the drugs that they're insensitive to the drug, and they take over the population, and pretty soon you have a population of resistant pathogens. And that, a few years ago, led me to start studying host-oriented approaches to treating infectious diseases. Whether one can, the notion of attacking the pathogen and leaving the host untouched hasn't worked out, because, as we all know, antimicrobials are toxic to the host too. But so it might be possible, I thought, to develop therapeutic approaches that would have a therapeutic window, affect the host's ability to support the growth of the pathogen without killing the host or causing toxicity to the host. And that is, as I've said, that in addition to the pathogen itself doesn't produce disease, the host is an important ingredient in the disease. Now, host-pathogen interactions is something that there's been attention to for years, and they've commonly been viewed as adversarial, like a battle between the host and the pathogen, or in this instance with a virus, the host cell is resisting the attack by the virus. But there's another side to host-pathogen interactions, and that is that the pathogens exploit host genes to be pathogenic. In this example here, it was a virus. It's not the virus itself that produces the disease, but the virus interaction with the host produces the disease. In order for the virus to produce the disease, it's got to bind to the cell, Its genome has to be internalized, its genes have to be expressed, it's protein processed, it has to be replicated, it has to produce a pathogenic event, and then it has to get out of the cell. It has to go through morphogenesis and be released. And we have been calling the cellular genes that are exploited by pathogens CGEPs, cellular genes exploited by pathogens. And we've set out to look for such genes for a number of pathogens and toxins. Now, anthrax toxicity, which is another area where this kind of thing is useful to illustrate. For anthrax toxicity to occur, the protective antigen, or the carrier part of anthrax toxin, has to bind to a receptor on the cell. It's cleaved by a host enzyme, furin, and the 63 kilodalton subunit heptamerizes. It interacts with the edema factor, or lethal factor, the bismuth parts of the anthrax toxin, and it's brought into the cell. It's endocytosed. And in the endosome is acidified. It releases the edema factor, or lethal factor, which do their terrible thing and kill the cell or create problems. And all of these steps require the cooperation of host genes. And so, again, the question is, could we interfere with the effects of toxicity by interfering with host gene function? And in talking with colleagues again about this, the point was, the idea sounds interesting, but aren't you worried that targeting host genes instead of the pathogen will have toxic effects on the host? And the answer was yes, but maybe there's a window, and it turns out that there is, and we've shown this at this point for a number of pathogens. Now, how to find such host genes that are exploited by pathogens? In bacterial cells, it's very easy to identify gene function. They carry only a single copy of a gene, only one chromosome, and a single copy of a gene, and you mutate the gene, and then select or screen for those cells that acquire a phenotype that you're interested in as a result of the gene inactivation. But in mammalian cells, which are the hosts we're talking about, it's more complicated because they have two copies of each gene, and if you mutate one copy, the other copy is still functional. And the question is, how do you get an activation of both copies concurrently? This was before siRNA or any of those things. And if a cell has a mutation of one copy and that natural occurrence is at a frequency of 1 in 10 to the 5, then a same cell mutated in two copies of the same gene is 10 to the minus 5 times 10 to the minus 5, or 10 to the minus 10, which is obviously a very low frequency. So we developed a procedure, and the we in that instance was Lehman Lee, who was a postdoc in my lab, and I developed a procedure to accomplish random homozygous knockout, and it is to grow cells to inactivate genes randomly by inserting a lentivirus carrying a promoter into the chromosome. And when this promoter is turned on, it reads through the end of the lentivirus into the chromosomal sequence bracketing the insertion site, and it makes antisense to that sequence, and it's antisense to the RNA made by the other allele as well as by the allele that it's inserted in. And then it was to select those cells and that had a phenotype, and now there are multiple ways of doing this gene silencing. People use ribozymes, homozygous recombination, antisense, or RNAi. But I want to say, for a pitch for this work that was now published maybe 15 years ago, these other approaches require that you know the gene sequence before you make the RNAi. And with the lentivirus approach, it's agnostic. You don't need to know any gene sequence. It takes care of splice variants and things of that sort, for those of you who are biologists and know what I'm talking about. And the first gene that was identified using this approach was TSG101, which was isolated by a tumor susceptibility gene selection procedure by Li Min. And this is just the terracotta warriors in Xi'an in China. TSG101 has many faces like the terracotta warriors, not 7,000 or so as exists in these terracotta warriors, but many. And so Li Min identified this gene And in studying its functions, we learned that the way, one of the ways in which it works is it affects a process, endocytic processing of receptors from the cell surface. So that if one considers a receptor on the cell surface, when it binds to a ligand, in this instance, it's epidermal growth factor, it's endocytosed to the early endosome and goes to the late endosome, which forms something called a multivesicular body, and a decision is made by the cell. Either the receptor is cycled back to the surface where it can interact again with a ligand, or it's cycled to the lysosome where it's degraded. And it turns out that Carol Carter, who is a scientist at Stony Brook, New York State University at Stony Brook, made an interesting observation. And she observed that TSG101, which we had reported and described, interacts with a protein made by HIV called the GAG protein, which is involved in release of the GAG. And to make a long story short, the way that TSG is used by HIV in release, HIV mimics the process of receptor recycling, and HIV gets to the surface of cells by using TSG101 and its other molecules that it interacts with for release. And that discovery was made not only by us, but we were scooped. It was made by Wes Sundquist, who published an elegant paper in Cell some months before we did, showing that TSG101 and the vesicular protein sorting pathway are essential for HIV budding. So this was really the paradigm of host gene exploitation by a virus. Well, okay, and since that time, TSG has been shown to be exploited by multiple other viruses in multiple ways. And these are some of the other pathogens that are potentially applicable for the same type of approach. We've studied CGEPs. We've isolated CGEPs that are exploited by a number of these pathogens. I should say that the three most important factors in function-based target discovery are shown in this slide. It's sort of like real estate. The three most important factors are assay, 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 rather than location, location, location. And as a geneticist, I can tell you that if you have a good assay, you can isolate or identify almost anything. And we set out to set up an assay for CGEPs that are exploited in anthrax toxicity. And I'm getting late, I guess, in the hour, so I won't go into great detail, but to make a long story short, it was possible to identify genes that reduce the sensitivity to anthrax toxin by several orders of magnitude. And we reported some of these genes. This was the first one we found. We reported in PNAS. This is a cell paper that Wensing Wei and other people in my lab published a few years ago, which assists the anthrax toxin in getting in. And very recently, we found a third receptor for anthrax toxin. And at this point, as a result of work that we've done and work in other labs, there are 17 different CGEPs that have been identified as being exploited by anthrax toxin for anthrax toxicity. So the question is, can these CGEPs, since they all function to help anthrax toxin get in, and we all know that there is individual variability to most infections, is it possible that these CGEPs collectively determine how susceptible individual cells may be to anthrax toxin? Now, the notion of genetic variability affecting infectious disease is not a new notion. I think you all know about sickle cell anemia and malaria, and this is perhaps another very good example related to malaria. There's an allele, the dark FY star O allele, which is prevalent in this part of Africa, which is exactly the part the distribution mirrors the distribution of vivax malaria. So We set out to look for the effects of genetic variability on anthrax toxicity. And I'm going to just show you a couple of slides briefly because I'm running out of time. But I do want to introduce a concept here which I think is important. Lots of laboratories around the world are doing what are called GWAS studies, genome-wide association studies, in the area of genomics. And what they do is they look for polymorphisms in individual genes, and they try to associate this with a phenotype. And these studies are problematical. And one of the reasons they're problematical is that there are millions and millions of polymorphisms, and the associations are in most instances rather tenuous, and you have to set a threshold for association which is low enough that you get a lot of false positives, but nevertheless, GWAS has produced interesting results. So a while back, by about a year or so ago, maybe 2 years ago now, I had the idea, we call it CPAS. Instead of genome-wide associations, perhaps we could do CGEP pathogenicity association studies. And that's possible to do because there are projects going on in genomics. This is an example of one, the 1,000 Genome Project, where there are genomes of 1,000, there will eventually be 2,000 or 3,000 different individuals that are sequenced. And the sequences are generally available. But equally important is the fact that at the time that the DNA is taken from these individuals that are sequenced, and they come from different parts of the world, they're the Han Chinese, Japanese, there are Yorubans in Nigeria, there are Europeans, lymphocytes, or a buffy coat of blood is taken. And the lymphocytes in the buffy coat of blood, the B lymphocytes, are transformed by Epstein-Barr virus, so they're immortalized. And the lymphocytes from the individuals whose sequences are available are then identified or available. And this is just, I guess, the last science slide I want to show. This is just some of the studies. We've studied the anthrax toxin variability of lymphocytes from, at this point, over 250 of these individuals. And the point I want to make is that they're now, this is only a first 100 or 100 or some, now there's a 100-fold difference in variability of cells from different individuals and their sensitivity to anthrax toxin. I don't know that, we certainly haven't exposed these persons to anthrax and asked whether there's variability in individual sensitivity to anthrax, but I can tell you their cells, which are a good reflection of that, show huge differences in sensitivity. And so we've done CPAS studies and associated differences in genetic variability with particular CGEPs. And we found polymorphisms that determine susceptibility to anthrax toxin, and also that the level of expression of these genes affect individual susceptibility to anthrax toxin. And I guess since my time is more than over, I should stop here rather than going into further detail. These are some of the people that I've had the privilege of having in my lab and collaborating with over the years in the work that I've talked about, specifically Chris Miller, who was in my lab for many years and has been involved in a number of these studies, Annie Chang, Herb Boyer, whose collaboration I mentioned, Malcolm, Bob Helling, who collaborated in some of the early studies with Herb and me. These are the people who did the DNA replication, origin isolation, and some of the other people over the period of years. I guess I don't have time to go into that, but I want to thank you very much for your attention, and thank you again for inviting me to give this lecture.